Yeah, so let us see. So this is a signal flow graph numerical. In this numerical, what is asked is you have to find what is CS by RS. But not all the numerical, generally what happens is we check the whole numerical from the end. So signal flow graph and block reduction, first we check whether the final answer is correct or not. So if final answer is correct, then we start checking what are the smaller parts are there. So let us start from the beginning. First, we have to find what are the forward paths. So in this case, you are finding there are three forward paths. So T1 is the path one. So that is ABDE. That is the first path. Second path is T2, that is M. So this is from starting to the end. Okay, there is one a path which is having again M. So whenever we are doing last module, that is whenever we will be doing state space analysis, there you will find that there is something called as a D matrix. So you don't need to understand, just you have to remember. And whenever we are doing that state space analysis, again maybe we will come to this numerical and I will show you what is the significance of D matrix. So D matrix is called as a direct transmission matrix. Generally we don't find like this, that input is directly taken to output. Okay, so if we don't want to do any kind of processing, if in part of the input is supposed to come to output directly, then why are you doing all this thing in between? So generally it doesn't happen like that in systems. But yes, in case of some numerical, for example, for solution theory, we can ask something like this. So this M part is called as a direct transmission part. This is directly connected from input to the output side. And this is having a gain of capital M. Okay, so this is the second forward path, which is called as capital M. And third forward path you are finding. So here, this C is actually a forward path. Okay, so this is a confusing example. So this BH1, this is a feedback path, individual loop. You are finding L1 is BH1 and L2 is E of minus H2. So this BH1 is a positive feedback path. So everything is there in this numerical. You are finding parallel paths, you are finding direct transmission matrix, you are finding a loop with positive feedback, you are finding loop with negative feedback. So there's a very simple, harmless kind of numerical, but you'll be finding all the cases that is possible. Okay, the self loop is not there. What is a self loop? Suppose here in some numerical we have seen that a starting point and end point, it is same. Okay, so that means from this point only, a goal aisa balloon jaisa draw kar diya. Okay, so that is called a self loop. So except self loop, all of the things are there. So first path is ABDE, second path is M. This is the M direct transmission. Third path is ABCE, that is AB and then C and then E. Okay, so these are the three paths. So non-touching loop, we are finding that these two loops, BH1 and EH2, they are non-touching. So L2 is minus EH2, first path is BH1. And there is one pair of non-touching loop, that means multiplication of the gain. So this will be BEH1H2-. So that we have found BEH1H2-. Now, whenever we are doing for the numerator part, you are finding this M. Okay, so this M path is not touching this, it is not touching this, and it is non-touching for both these things. So how to write the numerator part? It will be M, M into 1 minus BH1 plus EH2 minus BEH1H2. So this is M, this is not touching the first loop. So that's why this gain is here. It is not touching the second loop that is there. And both these loops are also non-touching. So pair of non-touching loop and their gain. So these are the four terms coming with M. So M is a forward path which is not touching any of the loops. And these two loops are also non-touching. So this is what we are finding as a numerator. And two other paths, that is A, B, C, E, and ABDE, they are also coming in the numerator and they are touching all the loops, and denominator is same, it is understandable. So 1 minus individual loops plus multiplication of gain of two non-touching loop. So this is CS by RS. So this is the overall transfer function for the given SFG. So this much if you do, generally we check this final thing and we find that okay, this is correct. When we find this is correct, then we go back and we check the intermediate steps. Okay, so these are the intermediate steps. That's what I told you, that whenever you are finding SFG numerical, do the parts very sincerely. So in one shot, just looking at it, you can write down this final answer, but that will not give you 10 marks. You have to do all the intermediate parts. So what are the forward paths? 2 marks. What are the individual loop? 2 marks. If there are two non-touching loops and multiplication of their gain, 2 marks. And then forward path and non-touching loop, that is generally we find P1 delta 1. So what is the delta 1, delta 2, delta 3? So you are finding delta 1 and delta 2 are 1 and 1 because these two loops are touching all the these two forward paths, I'm sorry, are touching all the loops. So that's why delta 1, delta 2 is equal to 1. But delta 3 means whenever you're talking about M, this is a forward path. This is not touching any of the loops, and there are two non-touching loops also we are finding. So delta 3 will be some very big thing, 1 minus BH1, EH2 minus BEH1, H2 and all those things. So this is delta 1, delta 2, delta 3 we have found. And this is the way we find CS by RS. So this is the way you are supposed to write it in the exam. Next is another numerical. What we are finding is RLC series circuit, the values are given. Okay, so now you have done this experiment number 5, experiment number 6. So in experiment number 5, I have asked you to design first which are the zeta. And for 8 cases are given, for every zeta, you are supposed to find out what is the response. So here, let us find out. So R is given as 2, L is given as 1, and C is given as 0.5. First, we have found out what is omega n. So omega n, directly finding omega n is little wrong. So first, you are supposed to find out what is zeta. Okay, so finding zeta would be the first step. So zeta is equal to 0.707, which is less than 1. So this could be the first step. Whenever you are finding that zeta is underdamped, then you have to say that yes, there will be frequency in this case in output. So here omega n we are finding directly means we are more overconfident, that is yes, frequency usme rehne hi wala hai, but this is not the case. So here you just swap the answer a little bit. I'm contradicting myself, but anyways, whatever is correct is correct. So this is not wrong what I have doing, but there is a policy issue and there is a proper arrangement issue in this. So first, whenever second order RLC system is given, first thing you are supposed to find is zeta. And zeta you are finding as less than 1, in between 0 and 1. And then you have to comment that, yes, zeta is in between 0 and 1. That means there will be frequency in the system. Because zeta greater than 1, zeta is equal to 1. In that case, there is no frequency. If zeta is 0, in that case, we are finding it is only frequency component, that is the sustained oscillation. So in this case, you have to see. So I'm doing all this numerical, all this pages I'm showing you just to how to do it in the exam. Okay, so this is more professionally it is done. So follow the same pattern in the exam as well. Zyada nahi likhna hai, but whatever is required, those part you must write. Okay, so this document also I will upload in your group shortly, you will find. So zeta is equal to 0.707. After that, you have to say it is underdamped. Underdamped means there will be frequency. Then find omega n, then find omega d, and then find other time parameters. So omega n I am finding as 1.414 radian per second. Omega d I have found is omega n into root under of 1 minus zeta square, that is little less, that is 1 radian per second. So omega n is called as undamped natural frequency, and omega d is called as damped frequency. And damped frequency will be lesser than natural frequency. And as zeta is increasing, this omega d value will keep on decreasing, and at zeta is equal to 1, omega d will be equal to 0. That means when the system becomes from under damp, it is going towards critical damp. So exactly at critical damp, there is no frequency present in the system output. So this is the idea. And then you are supposed to find out delay time, rise time, peak time, settling time. And settling time, there are two settling time. One is 2% settling time, there is 5% settling time. So 5% settling time is a little less because it is towards the left side. It is 3 divided by zeta omega n. And 2% settling time is a little higher. So that is equal to 4 by zeta omega n. So this we all know. So we have calculated delay time. We have calculated rise time. So while calculating delay time, there is no problem. While calculating rise time, all the problem comes because this is pi minus theta by omega d. And all this pi, theta, everything is in radian. So pi value is 3.14, theta value you have to calculate from the beginning. So have we calculated theta? Let me check. So we have not calculated theta, but somewhere you have to calculate the theta. How to calculate theta? This is tan inverse of 0.707 root under. So there is a formula. I think tan inverse root under of 1 minus zeta square by zeta, something like that. Formula is there. So from there you have to find theta in radian. Okay. So we have found out theta in radian, 0.785. So that you plug in here, and you find how much is the rise time. So delay time should be smallest, rise time should be a little more than that, peak time should be little more than that, and settling time 5% should be little more than peak time, and settling time 2% will be highest. So what is the smallest value? Delay time is the smallest. We found here it is 1.05. Rise time is little higher, 2.355 order in seconds. Peak time is further higher, 3.14 seconds. We have found out 2% settling time will be highest. Okay, so after rise time, you have to find what is 5% settling time. So 5% settling time will be 4 by zeta omega in seconds, and that will be a little higher than peak time. And finally, there will come 2% settling time. This is 4 by zeta omega n. And zeta and omega n is adjusted in such a way that if they are multiplied, they are going to give you the value of 1 in this case. Okay, so zeta omega n is called as time constant of the whole system. Zeta into omega n. This is called as time constant of the whole system. And for second order RLC, there are only two design parameters. One is zeta, damping. It decides how fast or how slow the system response is. And another is omega n, which is called as whenever there is oscillation, what is going to be the natural frequency of oscillation, that is given by omega n. And then percentage peak overshoot, percentage MP, all these things. So these proofs are also asked in the exam. Delay time, rise time, peak time. So all the proofs you can find out from the book of M. Gopal. I had shown you the page numbers and everything. So please find out. So percentage MP we are finding out is 4.328. 4.328 means this height, this peak point will be 1.04328. Okay, so maximum height acceptable is 40%. More than 40%, if MP is, in that case, it is going to be very troublesome. Okay, so it is a lot less than that. It is only 4%, 4.3%. So that is okay within the limit. So this peak, whenever we define a second order system, we have to see that this peak is not less than 40%. That means this peak height should not be more than 1.4. Okay, in that case, too much of energy is getting concentrated around this time, and too much of error is created due to the second order underdamped response. So time response diagram, this is a very big thing that this diagram will not be asked, but you have to show this diagram at the end of whenever you are doing a numerical. So draw this diagram, and after drawing this diagram, show how much is TD, how much is TR, how much is TP, how much is 2% settling time, how much is percentage MP. All those values you should mention here in this graph. So this graph is really an impression creator. Whenever this kind of numerical is asked, at the end of the numerical, you have to draw this diagram and you have to say that, sir, whatever result you had asked, I have found it and I'm showing it in the diagram. Okay, so this kind of diagram you should show. Ye puchega nahi, but you have to do it. If you do it, it really creates a very good impression. It doesn't take much time. Okay, and calculation also doesn't take much time, provided every calculation has to be done in radian. And after that, you have to draw this diagram and show all the timing constraints. Next thing, I have given two poles, and I think I have asked you to find out what is the system response and what are the different system response for different position of poles. So this is a favorite question of mine, though I did not set this paper, but it is asked that say what is the position of the poles and what is the time domain response for that. Now, time domain response means I am asking impulse response here. So in this case, okay, so there's actually step response we have found out. So question I had to see. So this is minus 2 plus 2, 3j and minus 2 minus 3j. So these are the two poles, and we are finding that this is a underdamped case. So just looking at the poles only, you should be able to understand which case is this. So first is, this is stable. Stable because the poles are in the left hand side of j omega axis. And second thing is, the position of the poles are telling me that this is going to be a underdamped response. Underdamped response means this will be sinusoidal, but this will be a damping or diminishing kind of a sinusoidal. And this is a stable response. So how to show that? What is the direct graph? So this is minus 2. So it will be e raised to minus 2t, and this is plus minus 3j. So it will be sine 3t. Sine 3t means omega is equal to 3 radian per second. And this is the envelope, e raised to minus 2t. This two together will produce what is called as a diminishing sinusoid. So there is a stable system. Both poles are in the left hand side. So I think the question was given as from the pole position. So pole position is given. From the pole position, find out what is going to be its time domain response and what is going to be the stability. So from the pole position, you can directly, so zyada hum logo sochne ki time nahi hai abhi, because we are going towards the end part of the whole syllabus. So hum logo abhi fatafat karna hai, we should be able to understand the things and create the result very fast. So we have to say that minus 2 means what will be the response? E raised to minus 2t sine 3t. So it is e raised to minus 4 plus 5j. If I give you minus 4 plus minus 5j, what will be the response? E raised to minus 5t sine 4t. I'll repeat. If I give you minus 5 plus minus 4j, in that case, what will be the response? E raised to minus 5t sine 4t. That means omega will be 4 and this envelope will be e raised to minus 5t. And again, that will be a diminishing kind of a sinusoidal, but that rate of falling of the sinusoidal will be very fast, because e raised to minus 5t is a lot faster falling than e raised to minus 2t. So this is a stable waveform. That is the first thing. This is a diminishing waveform. This is a time domain response. And that's it. And if you just find out, you will be finding that this is underdamped. So how can you find out what is the transfer function? So denominator, you have to write s plus 2 minus 3j and s plus 2 plus 3j. So this will be s plus 2 whole square minus 9. So that if you do, so this will be or plus minus. So this will be s square minus 3j. Sorry, s plus 2 whole square minus 3j square. So denominator. So denominator will be s square plus 4s plus 4 plus 9. So denominator will be s square plus 4s plus 13. Wo bhi dekh ke bolna hai. What is this? S minus 2. S minus 2 means s plus 2 whole square minus of 3j whole square. So 3j whole square means 9j square. Man, means 9 minus 9. So denominator will be s plus 2 whole square plus 9. That means s square plus 4s plus 4 plus 9, that is s square plus 4s plus 13. So, ye sab fatafat karna hai. If I give you minus 5 plus minus 4j, what will be the denominator? So, minus 5 plus minus 4j, the denominator will be s square plus 10s. 10s kaha se aaya? 2 into 5. Okay, so s square plus 10s plus 25 plus 16, because this is minus 5 plus 4j or minus 5 minus 4j. So, minus 5 square, that is 25, and 4 square, that is 16. So, 25 plus 16 is 41. So if I give you minus 5 plus minus 4j, in that case denominator will be s square plus 10s plus 41. So ye jaldi jaldi karna hai. In the pole 0 we have to see that. And then next case, so next case, this is minus 2 and minus 5. What is the time domain response? Time domain response is like this. It will increase and it will fall. It is a asymptotically stable thing, and you are finding that area under the curve is finite, and this is actually a kind of an impulse response for overdamped case. Okay, so if you just find out s plus 2 and you'll be finding this is s square plus 7s plus 10. So root 10 is the omega n, and 2 zeta omega n is equal to 7. So from all these calculations, if you're calculating, you'll be finding zeta will be greater than 1. So this is an overdamped case you're finding. Third case, okay, the system is stable here. System is stable because this response is actually coming to a zero at t tends to infinity. So what is the value of steady state error? Steady state error will be there because in this case the amplitude is going to zero. We will find out what is the state. So impulse response, if it is there, in that case steady state error will not be there. Third case, there are two poles. One is given at minus 4, one is given at zero. What is the stability of this system? Stability of the system will be marginally stable because this pole is on j omega axis. So whenever there is a pole at j omega axis, the system will be marginally stable. And what is the time response? Time response, it will be increasing and it will be staying at some amplitude. So this amplitude you can calculate. So these are the three responses. So 2 marks is given each. And if you think I will sit and calculate it for 1 hour, you can do that. But very fast you should be able to just see the pole position and you should be able to write what is the output. So what is the type of the output, what is the stability, and what is the impulse response, step response, all those things we should be able to calculate very fast. So there's a fundamental kind of numerical. Another thing is possible that I will give you two poles at minus 2 minus 2. So you have done already this case in your experimentation. So two pole at minus 2 minus 2, in that case you are finding that it will be a critically damped response. So at critically damped, the same pole are there on real axis in the left side, but both poles are there on the same position. So I give you two poles at minus 3 minus 3 or two poles at minus 2 minus 2. Both cases you will be finding that response again will be stable, and response in time domain will rise fast. So this is impulse response I have drawn. Step response, if you are drawing, it will be rising very fast because for critically damped system the rising time is quite less. So this is another numerical what we have done. Another case for RLC circuit, step input output is taken across capacitor general form. So I think I have asked to find out what is the time domain response. Okay, so the same thing is done, you can see that. So for different cases, this is for underdamped case, zeta is equal to zero. So this is a document perfectly prepared for exam. Okay, hence I will post you all this, and you can solve all this, and you can find out what is the case when zeta is equal to zero. At that time, what is the case and how to find the output. So first, you are supposed to find out what is the CS, that is what is the output. So 1 by S minus S by zeta square omega n square. This is a second order RLC system output equation for step input. And whenever you are finding that zeta is equal to zero, in that case, if you substitute zeta is equal to zero here, you will find CT is equal to 1 minus cos omega nt. So this is a graph of cos omega nt, or rather minus cos omega nt and added with 1. Because whenever we are plotting cos, we will be finding that it starts from a certain value. Why is it minus cos? Because now it is starting from below and it has been added. So this is first you have to plot cos t, and then you have to do minus cos t, you have to invert it, and then you have to add 1 with that. Okay, so this will actually 1 volt DC has been added with the AC of cos omega, and the whole waveform actually shifts up. Okay, so if you are checking this waveform in the CRO, you will be finding that if you have set the ground line somewhere here at the center, this waveform will go shifted up. So this is kind of a clamped input. I think you have done clipping clamping circuit. So this is a kind of a positive clamped output you are going to check. So this is a second order undamped response for step input when both the poles of the system are on j omega axis. So it is sustained oscillation. And if it is 3 cos 3t, that means you are going to find that there will be 3 oscillations within 2 pi. All those things you can find out. Okay, then comes our topic, that is the topic of Routh-Hurwitz criterion. So those are the 3 numericals which are written perfectly in exam format. That's what I was explaining. So yesterday we have seen Routh-Hurwitz criterion, and we have seen how to find out stability from Routh-Hurwitz criterion. So we have seen how to write the table of Routh-Hurwitz criterion. From there, you have to calculate the cross multiplication, all these things, the way it is done in matrix. Here, it is done in the reverse way. So in the matrix determinant calculation, we take, so if there are 4 things, so left, right, top, bottom, like this, there are 4 elements here in this case, like this. Suppose it is 2, 0, 0, or let's say 1, 2, 1, 0, like this. So in determinant finding, what you do is 1 into 0 minus 1 into 2. Okay, but in this case, it is reverse. In this case, you are supposed to do is 1 multiplied by 2 minus 1 multiplied by 0 divided by 1. This is the way you have to do. So 2, 0, 1, 0, how do we do? 2 multiplied by 0 minus 1 multiplied by 0 divided by 2. So as you are finding these 2 elements are 0, in that case, the first row element of A square will be equal to 0. And this is problematic, because whenever you are going to find the next element S rest to 1, what is the element going to be? It will be infinity, because now it is 0 into 0 minus 2 into 6 divided by 0. Okay, so all the elements in the denominator will be infinity. So Routh-Hurwitz criterion, we have done numerically yesterday, and then we started with the special cases. And I told you that this question can be asked as a theory that explain what are the special cases with the help of numerical. So in this case, you have to remember this numerical, because sitting in the exam hall, you cannot produce this kind of numerical, not possible. So you have to remember this case, you have to show this case, and you have to say that if we are finding that first row element is becoming zero, in that case, we have to substitute it by a very small value, small positive value, which is given by the symbol. And now again, you have to redo the Routh-Hurwitz criterion from wherever it got stuck. Okay, so S cube, no problem, 200, and then from S square, you are doing like this. So either you do it in the right side, it doesn't look good. So I was trying to save space, that's what I gone to right side. But actually in real case, you can do in the same column itself. So lamba ase karo, it'll be easier for you to understand. And in this kind of numerical, you have to practice. There's the easiest 10 marks you can get in the exam. So though sometime SS to 7 like characteristic equation is given, but then also Routh-Hurwitz criterion every student find very easy. Please don't make mistake in cross multiplication, division, and all those things, and understand these 2 cases. So there are only 3 types of numerical we are doing in Routh-Hurwitz. One is a normal case. Okay, simply Routh-Hurwitz criterion we are supposed to find out. So there is no first element to be zero. There is no case where the whole row is becoming zero. All those things are not there. Simple RH criterion, we can calculate from S to 7 up to S to 0 and check how many sign changes are there in the first column. So in the first column, if there is no sign change, all the elements in the first column are positive or all the element in the first column are negative, in that case we have to say that the sign change in the first column is not there. That means there is no pole which is lying in the right side. So number of sign change in the first column is equal to number of poles which are lying in the right side for the closed loop negative feedback system. Okay, so in the first column, if you are finding there is no sign change, means there are no poles which are lying in the right hand side of S plane. It means that all the poles are lying in the left hand side of S plane, and whenever all the poles of a closed loop system it lies in the left hand side of S plane, it means that the system is perfectly stable. Okay, so in this case, how to find that? This is a special case. That's why special things happening, difficult things happening. So you are finding that S square. So this is a small numerical SS25, that means it's a fifth order system. That means there are five energy storing element in the system, whichever characteristic equation is given. So in that case, you are finding that S square, the first element, is becoming zero. So next element, another element becoming zero, no problem. But first element, whenever it is becoming zero, you have to replace it by a very small positive amount, 0.001, 0.0001 something. We are calling it by epsilon. So there's a symbol for that. And now with this symbol, you have to calculate what is the coefficient of SS21, SS20 and all. So if you're doing this, if you're substituting this zero with epsilon, the other parameters remains constant, whatever are there. So in this case, again, find what is the route table SS21 and SS20. So in SS21, how to calculate? So epsilon multiplied by zero minus 2 into 6. Okay, so this is minus 2 divided by epsilon. It is like this. And then what is the next line? Next line is this negative multiplied by 6 minus 0 divided by this negative. That means only 6 comes here. So now you have to say that what is the first column? So first column is 1, 1, 2, 2 epsilon and minus 12 by epsilon and 6. Okay, so 1, 1, 2 and then epsilon minus 12 by epsilon and 6. That means there are two sign changes. What is the sign change? So this is from the positive small value to negative. How much negative? Not important. Okay, so it is negative, that much is important. So there is one sign change, epsilon to negative, minus 12 by epsilon, and minus 12 by epsilon to 6. So from positive to negative, negative to positive, there are two sign changes. So final line, you have to say that in the first column, elements are 1, 1, 2, epsilon, minus 12 by epsilon, 6. As there are two sign changes, system is unstable, and there are two poles which are lying in the right side of S plane. So whenever I ask two questions, whether system is stable or unstable. If unstable, tell me how many poles are in the right side of S plane. So in this case, you have to say system is unstable because there is sign change in the first column and there are two sign changes in the first column. That means there will be two poles lying in the right hand side of S plane. What is the second case? So in the book of M. Gopal, you will be finding that this case, that is first element is becoming zero. This is actually the case number two. Okay. And next, whatever we are going to do here, whatever I have written, that is the whole row becomes zero. So suppose you are doing S5 row, S4 row, S3, you are calculating and you are finding that the whole S3 row becomes zero. So that is more difficult. That is the most difficult case. What to do in that, that we are going to see in case number two, as far as my writing. Okay, and no, not necessary that you have to make the case one as first element becomes zero, case two as all row becomes zero, as a which fix nahi hai. Anything can be case one, anything can be case two. So don't worry about that. So koi exam mein ye nahi puchega ke Routh-Hurwitz ka case one explain karo. Okay, it is not like that. Generally, question is asked what are the special cases in Routh-Hurwitz and explain. And whenever you are doing that explanation, do it by the help of two examples. So this was the first example. When the first row is becoming first row element is becoming zero, then what to do? Next case is element in one complete row becomes equal to zero, and this case is little tricky. You have to see what to do. So element in one complete row becomes equal to zero. Here take the previous row polynomial, differentiate it with respect to S and get next row coefficients and proceed further. So this we will understand by means of a numerical. So this also you have to remember. It's a big thing, so you can remember in books. You will be finding a smaller numerical with this problem, but if you solve this numerical also, there is no harm in that. So you have to remember what are the coefficients. So S^6, that means there are six energy storing elements. This is a characteristic equation of a big system with six energy storing elements. So there are six poles. Okay, and we have to find out how many poles are stable, how many poles are unstable pole. and we are trying to do it by Routh-Hurwitz criterion. So what is the even polynomial? So we will start with SS to 6 and we have to fall up to SS to 0. And then we have to check what is the first column. So SS to 6, what is the coefficient? 1. Then SS to 4 coefficient, that is the even polynomial, it is 8. Then S square coefficient, be very careful if there is any term dropped here. So you are finding that SS to 0 to SS to 6, no term is dropped. All the 7 terms are there. Be very careful while doing the Routh-Hurwitz criterion. Okay, silly mistakes only we can make. Otherwise, we should not lose a single mark in RH criterion. So 1, 8, and then 20, and then 16. So this is 1, 8, 20, and 16. And next is 2SS to 5. So this is the odd polynomial. So 2SS to 5 means this is 2. And then 12S cube, that's why it is 12. And 16S. 16S means it is 16. So this is the way we are supposed to find out what is the even polynomial and odd polynomial. And S is not there. So here you are supposed to write 0. So this is 16S ka 16, 12S ka 12, and 12S cube ka 12, and 2SS to 5 ka 2. And below this 16, there is nothing. So you can substitute it with 0. Now you are finding SS to 4. So SS to 4, you can find by the same RH method. So what is the step? 2 into 8, that is 16, minus 12, that is 4 divided by 2. So this first element is 2. So this is the first method, 2 into 8, minus 1 into 12 divided by 2, that is 4 by 2 is equal to 2. Next is 2 into 20, that is 40, minus 1 into 16, that is 16. So 40 minus 16 is 24. 24 divided by this 2, okay, that is equal to 12. So again, I'll tell you, so this is 2 into 20, minus 1 into 16, that is 40 minus 16, that is 24, divided by 2, that is this 12. Last column, 2 into 16, minus 1 into 0, divided by 2. So this is 2 into 16 divided by 2, that is equal to 16. Now you are finding that S5 and S4 row, both rows are same. So if you are doing this RH, you will be finding 2 into 12 minus 2 into 12 divided by 2, 0. 2 into 16 minus 2 into 16 divided by 0, 0. So all the elements in this case is becoming 0. So you have to remember this polynomial, and then only you can explain this case with the help of an example. So now what to do? So S cube row has become perfectly 0. Okay, in that case, S cube row has become perfectly 0. What you have to do is you have to go to the previous row. What is the previous row? It is the even polynomial row. So one thing you have to remember, that even polynomial means this is 2s raised to 4 plus 12s square plus 16. This is the point where students make mistake. Okay, what I have found, that students find up to S cube all zeros very perfectly, no problem. But after that, they get stuck. Okay, they are not able to write what to do then. So you have to go back. Okay, so if S cube is all 0, then you have to check SS to 4. And this SS to 4, whenever you are writing, don't make mistake. This is an even polynomial. Even polynomial means only 0, 4, 2, 6, 8, all this thing can be the power of S. Okay, so what is this? SS to 4 and 2. So this is 2SS to 4. Next is 12S square plus 16. Okay, so this is what I have written. 2SS to 4 plus 12S square plus 16. And now you differentiate it with respect to S. So if you're differentiating with respect to S, you are going to get 8S cube plus 24S plus 0. So next, whatever row was becoming 0 initially, after differentiation, you are finding 8S cube and 24S. So write S4 again. S4 is 2, 12, 16, 0. And then S cube, write S 8 and 24 and 0. So this is the step that you have to follow. For whichever step you are getting stuck, suppose if you are getting stuck at SS to 4, that means all the elements in SS to 4 become 0, then what to do? You have to go back. So in that case, you have to write 2SS to 5 plus 12S cube plus 16S is equal to 0. And differentiate that. 2S cube plus 12S plus 12S cube plus 16S is equal to 0. Differentiate that, and you will be finding something in SS to 4. And those equations, those coefficients, you plug in here. So whichever row you get stuck, you have to go to the previous row. You have to check whether it's an even polynomial or odd polynomial. If it's an even polynomial, then 2SS to 4, 12S square plus 16, differentiate that with respect to S. So this is what you have to explain in this method 2 or special case 2. What you have to write is, number 1, in the special case 2, we find that one whole row may become 0. That is the first, that is a problem. How to solve it? Solution, step number 1, we have to go to the previous row. So previous row in this case is 2s is to 4 plus 12 square plus 16. That is the first step. Second, differentiate the previous row polynomial. That is the even polynomial. What we are getting? 8s cube plus 24s. Then take the coefficients from that and plug in s cube. So what is the coefficients? 8s cube and 24s. So 8 and 24. These are the things we have to take. And plus 0. So that 0 is coming here. So 8 and 24 we are writing here and 0 we are writing here. So again you have to write s4, 2, 12, 16, whatever we have calculated previously. And then write s cube. S cube is 8 and 24. And then keep on doing the same RH criterion as our normal equation, as our normal numerical. So finding this 8 and 24, this is the whole trick in this numerical. So this is a process. Wherever you're getting stuck, go to the previous step, do the differentiation, get the coefficient for lower order of s, because here you got stuck at s cube. Go to the previous, write down equation in s is to 4, differentiate it, you are going to get equation in s cube. And whatever are the coefficients of s cube, take that, plug in, proceed. So what will be the next line then? S square. So s cube you are finding from differentiation of the previous polynomial. And now 8s cube, 24s plus 0. So 8 into 12, 96, minus 2 into 24, 48. That means it's 48 by 8, that is 6.
Sir, if S5 rows are all are 0, sir, what we have to take?
S5 row all are 0. S5 row cannot be 0. S5 row cannot be 0. In that case, the numerical given itself is wrong.
Sir, if even polynomial rows are all 0, sir, then what we have to take?
Which one? S, even polynomial means this one?
Yes, sir.
It cannot be 0 because numerical, even polynomial given 0 means you have to go to the previous step. Suppose we are finding that S square becomes 0. The same numerical, see, S4 cannot be 0. S4 is 0 means you have to go to S5. S4 cannot be 0. If S4 is 0, let's say, okay, fine, it can happen. If S4 is 0, then you have to go to S5. So 2S5 plus 12S cube plus 16S. That is equal to 0. Then differentiate it. You will be getting 2s to 5. That means 10s to 4 you will be getting. So that 10 will come here. So whichever row you are finding to be 0, go to the previous row, differentiate it, get the polynomial in lower and plug it here. Is it Kiran who is asking the question?
Yes, sir.
I will do numerical. So let me go out of this theory. I will do some numerical, you will understand. All the cases will do. So whichever row you are finding 0, you have to go to the previous step and you have to get this polynomial, differentiate it, get the lower order polynomial and plug. So let me do 2-3 numericals. We'll be doing numericals, you will understand. Okay, next, what is the step? Don't worry, Kiran, we'll be solving numerical. Okay, so next, what we are going to do is 8 and 24. So now find S square, S and SS to 0, the same way. So this is 96 minus 48, that is 48 divided by 8, this is 6. Next is 8 into 16, minus 2 into 0 divided by 8. So that is going to be 16. So this is 8 into 16, minus 2 into 0 divided by 8. So that 16 is here. What is the next thing? 6 into 24, that is 144, minus 8 into 16. Okay, so that is around 128, I guess. Okay, so 144 minus 128 divided by 6. So that we are going to get is 2.67. So calci acche se operate karna hai. So 6 into 24 minus 8 into 16 divided by 6, we are going to get 2.67. And last time, 7 into 16 minus 0 divided by 2.67, this is 16. And now you have to check the whole numerical starting from SS to 6 and up to SS to 0. And you have to say that all this first column, SS to 6, SS to 5, SS to 4, S cube, you have to take the calculated parameter for S cube coefficient 8, then S square, then S and then 0. So you have to say that these three elements and below these four elements, all the seven elements are having same sign. Don't say positive. Okay, don't say positive, don't say negative. You have to say that all the elements in the first column is having same sign. That means there is no sign change. As there is no sign change, the first column, in that case, RH table gives that the whole polynomial which is given. What is the polynomial? Polynomial is this one. That is SS to 6 plus 2SS to 5, 8SS to 4, all these things plus 16. So this is the denominator equation of a transfer function. So that transfer function or that system whose characteristic equation is this, that system is not having any unstable pole because all the element in the first column is of same sign. Positive is not important, is of same sign, that is important. So now that's why you are finding that all the things are same sign, that means the system is completely stable. So this is the case 2. So case 1 and case 2 will be solving many numericals just now from the book of M. Gopal, and that will finish our case. This numerical we have seen yesterday. This was an easy numerical. So s is to 4 s cube 20 s square 9 s plus 100. And this I think I had explained yesterday. So this is the Routh-Hurwitz criterion. So from the numerical polynomial, first we are finding the even and odd polynomial. So even polynomial is s is to 4 plus 20 s square plus 100. So that's why it is 120 and 100, and then s cube and 9s, so this is 1 and 9, and you are finding all this first column element, and you are finding that s is having negative coefficient, s square is having positive, and s is having, s to 0 is having positive coefficient. So there are two sign changes. This is something you have to understand. So it is written here very clearly. I'll be posting these notes as soon as possible. So this is the first sign change from s square to s is the first sign change, and s to 0 is the second sign change. So you have to say that there are two sign changes. Hence, out of four poles, there are two poles which are lying in the right hand side of S plane. Hence, the system is going to be unstable. And then there is another numerical, that is GSHS is given. And what is asked is find what is the steady state error for what is the input? Input is square input. So 4 of square input. Okay, so this is given. Input is 8 of square input, and find what is the error. Okay, so in that case, GSHS is given as k divided by s into s plus 3 into s plus 5, and then I have found out what is the different values of kp, kv, and ka. And in that case, we are giving the input as step input here. Okay, so that comes later on, but first we are finding kp, kv, ka. We are finding kp is equal to infinity, kv is finite, and ka is equal to 0. That means this is a type 1 system. So type 1 system is generally having kv as finite, kp as infinity, and ka as 0. And then we are finding what is the step unit step input. So unit step input is 1 by 1 plus kp plus this infinity. Here you are finding that esst for unit step input is 0. What is the for unit ramp input? Unit ramp input is 1 by kv. So it is 15 by k. Why 15 by k? Because you are finding that kv is k by 15. So 1 by k by 15, that is 15 by k. K value is not given. And we have given that square input. So square input is 4 units. So this is 8 by 2. 4 unit of square unit is 8 by 2. So in that case, you are finding whatever the value of square doesn't matter because we have found that k is equal to 0. So what is the a is 8 now. Okay, so this is actually 8 of square input. So 8 divided by 0, it is infinity. So these are the cases. Very easily we have found out what is steady state error. And there is coming something like that, root locus and all those things. So this root locus, we are not going to do now. And I have solved it. Two root locus I have solved here. And maybe after that I have solved Bode plot and all. So let it be. Okay, so this is a document which is fast track. So this was for fast track students. It was there. So I had written it. I had prepared the whole solution, and I will be uploading this solution to you later on. Okay. So what is there is I'm now going to go. So I'll stop presenting this current tab, and so now I'm going to the module number 4, module number 5. So concept of Routh stability criterion. There I'm going, and I am actually showing you some lot of other numerical. The concept of stability and Routh criterion, it is done, and we are going to see some more numericals on Routh criterion. Because in exam, a lot of different cases are asked. So it was page number 222, I guess. It was page number 222, so 222. So this was the starting of the chapter, and I'll be showing you some more Routh-Hurwitz criterion numerical. Any possible, we will enter the domain of root locus. Let us see. Okay. So I think my book is visible to all of you. So this is the first numerical. So let us see all the numericals that are done in case of this book of M. Gopal. And I have a list of some 8 to 10 numericals, but they all are having these three cases only. One is a normal case, very simple RH criterion you can find very sequentially. Second case is, so there are two special cases. In one case, the row becomes, all the element in the row becomes zero. And the third case, the first element in the row becomes zero. So the first in the row becomes zero, in that case you have to substitute by epsilon. And if all the row becomes zero, in that case you have to go to the previous step. Okay, exactly the previous step, write the polynomial, differentiate it, and whatever you get the equation next, plug in those values in the next row. So this is a big polynomial. I think we had done up till this. This is page number 226. This numerical was done yesterday. Now special cases. Special case. First special case, what they have taken is a row of all zeros. That means whatever is the second case from my notes, they have taken as the first case. Check this numerical. Check this numerical, and what you are finding is, here you are finding a odd row is becoming all zero. So first you have taken s to 5, s to 4, 4s cube, 24s square, 3s and 63. So in this case, it is s to 5, coefficient is 1. 4s cube, this is 4, and this is 3s, this is 3. Okay, and what is ss to 4? So now ss to 4. So these first two rows should be always given. So these are coming from the given polynomial. So ss to 4 means 1, and 24 square means 24, and 63 is constant. That means 63 into ss to 0. So ss to 0, remember this, all of you, ss to 0 is actually an even term. S square is an even term, ss to 4 is an even term. And s to 0, that is a constant, is also an even term. So we are finding 1, 4, 3 and 1, 24, 63. From there, what we are finding is, we are finding what is the first row element for s cube. So it is 1 into 4, that is 4, minus 24. That means minus 20 divided by 1. So this is becoming minus 20. Next line, it is 3, that is 1 into 3, minus 63. That means it is minus 60, minus 60 divided by 1. So this element is becoming minus 60. So first element is minus 20, second element is minus 60. If you can divide it by 20, or somebody wants, you can divide by minus 20 also. In this case, it will become minus 1 and minus 3. Now you have to do the s. So if you are here, so minus 1 into 24, so this is minus 24, and 1 minus or minus 3. So minus 24 plus 3. Minus 24, that is minus 1 into 24 is minus 24, and 1 into minus 3 of minus, that means plus. So that is minus 24 plus 3 divided by minus 1. So minus 21 divided by minus 1, so what you are getting is, it is 21. Next line, minus 1 into 63. That is minus 63 divided by minus 1, so you are finding it to be plus 63. So this is minus 63, that is minus 63. Divided by minus 1, because 1 into 0 is gone. So minus 63 divided by minus 1, you are finding it minus 63. So now you can see that 21, not minus 63, it becomes plus. 21 and 63, again you can divide by 21. So you are finding this row is also 1 and 3. So previous row is minus 1, minus 3. You can say it is as plus 1, plus 3 also. It doesn't matter because it's an equation. That means minus 1 s cube minus 3 s is equal to 0. That is same as s cube plus 3 s is equal to 0. Okay, so you can make it 1, 3, you can make it 1, 3. Whenever it is 1, 3 and 1, 3, you are finding it that s1 is becoming is equal to all zeros. Because 1 into minus 3, that is minus 3. Minus of minus 1 into minus 3, that becomes plus 3. So minus 3 plus 3 cancels. That means the first element is 0. And second element is 0 from, because there is nothing here. So the second element also will become zero. So in this case, what to do? So in this case, the S1, S to 1, this part has become zero. So go to the previous stage, go to the previous step. Previous step is of S square. So S square is having two coefficients, that is 1 and 3. That means S square plus 3 is equal to zero. Now differentiate, whenever you are finding that, next page it is given. So whenever you are finding that S to 1 is becoming all zero row, in that case, you have to go back to the S square. So S square plus 3, that is equal to 0, and differentiate it with respect to s. So in that case, it will be 2s. Okay, so in that case, it will be 2s. So differentiate it with respect to s. So it will be 2s. That means 2s plus 0. That means here you can write as 2. So this element you can write as 2. So in case of s is 1, you can write as 2. So what is there just above it? So this is 1, 3 and this is 2. And what will be the last column element in that case? It will be 2 into 3 divided by 2. So last column element will be 3. So they have used a different process below. But what I'm telling you is, after you find that this is a square plus 3, in that case, you differentiate it with respect to S, you'll be getting element as 2S. But 2S means here, instead of SS to 1, it will be 2. And above S square row is 1 and 3. So if this is 2, what will be the SS to 0? In that case, SS to 0 will be 2 into 3 divided by 2. That means it will be 3. So in the first column element, in that case, it will be 1, 1, minus 1, okay, and then again 1, and again 2 and 3. So what you'll be finding is, in order to examine the root, we divide by delta S to obtain this S cube, establishing the root. It will be 1, 1, minus 20 and 21. So what you are finding is there are two sign changes. In the sign in the first column indicates that presence of roots in the right half plane of S plane and system is unstable. So same thing you are finding here. That is 1, 1, minus 1, 1 and 2 and 3. That means there are two sign changes. One is from 1 to minus 1, another is from minus 1 to 1. And there are two sign changes. Hence, there are two poles in the right-hand side of S-plane and system will be unstable. So very important numerical this is. Please take care. And you don't divide by, while dividing, you don't change sign. This is my suggestion to you. So looking at this numerical, you could divide with minus 20 also. But don't play with sign whenever you are dividing it, the row. By any value. So don't change sign. Okay, in that case the whole fundamental will become different. So in this case only divide by the number. So if it is minus 20 and minus 60, then you can say it is minus 1 and minus 3. And because of this minus, so nothing happens below, because of this minus only, the whole system is going to be unstable. So the same process you have to find out. So you are finding this is 2, and if S raised to 1 is having coefficient of 2, SS to 0 will be having coefficient of 3, because 2 into 3 divided by 2, so SS to 0 will be having coefficient of 3. So in that case, first column element will be 1, 1, minus 1, 1, 2 and 3. And then you have to say that there are two sign changes. From S4 to S cube, it is becoming minus 1. S cube to S square, it is becoming plus 1. So there are two sign changes. Hence, the system is having two poles in the right hand side. System is unstable. And next, consider the sixth order system. So in this case, you are finding SS to 6, SS to 5, 8S to, so all those things. So SS to 6 means 1, 8 SS to 4 means 8, 20 S square means 20, and 16 is 16. And next is 2, 12 and 16. So 2, 12 and 16, I can write as 1, 6 and 8. And accordingly, if you're calculating, it will become 2, 12 and 16. Again, it will become 1, 6 and 8. So SS to 5 is having 1, 6 and 8, and SS to 4 is also having 1, 6 and 8. And S cube is going to be coming 0. So exactly this thing was asked by Kiran. Sir, what to do if some row becomes 0? So whichever row becomes 0, you no need to check what is the row, whether it is S cube or S4, does not matter. Whichever row is 0, excuse me, you have to go to the previous row. So what is the previous row? It is SS to 4 row, and it is 1, that means SS to 4 plus 6 S square plus 8. Okay, so this is a even polynomial. SS to 4 plus 6 S square plus 8. You take the differentiation, you are finding 4 and 12. So that 4 and 12 you plug here. That means S cube will be having two coefficients. One is 4, another is 12. And continue the RH criterion with that. So you are now substituting. S cube had become 0. So you had gone to the previous and you had found out divide by 4. And after that you had found out the differentiation. You found that 4 and 12 you are finding. So 4 and 12 also you can divide by 4. So don't change sign. You are finding it is 1 and 3. So whenever it is 1 and 3, so now S4 is 1 and 6 and S square, S cube is 1 and 3. So what is the next element then, S square? So this is 1 into 6 minus 1 into 3. That means 6 minus 3 divided by 1. So that's why it is becoming 3. Okay. So this is 1 into 6 minus 1 into 3. That is 6 minus 3 is 3. Divided by 1. So that's why you are finding it to be 3. So now it is 1, 3. That is S cube is having 1, 3. And S square is having 3. So how to find it then? 3 into 3, that is 9. Minus 1. So that is equal to 0. Divided by 3. So this is going to be 1 by 3. Okay, after finding this, you can find this one also. That is 1 into 8. Divided by 1. So this is becoming 8. Okay, likewise. And then S square, how to go for that? So this is a square is this. So this is 3 into 3. That is 9 minus 1 into 8. That is 9 minus 8. That is 1 and divided by 3. So from there it is coming to be 1/3. So up to which element you have to go, just keep on checking. So after you find a square as 1 and 3, you have to calculate this 8 also. So all this will come by experience. Don't worry. So all this numerical, whichever are solved, you solve this numerical first by pen and paper. And ek bar haath se karo. Without solving it by your own hand, you are not going to get the real feel of this Routh-Hurwitz criterion, because this is not difficult. Only thing is, you have to do a lot of practicing for this numerical. Okay, so ye art agar chhoot gaya, so your results will be different. Okay, so you have to understand that 1, 6, 8 is there, and then 1, 3 is there. That means there will come another element in the second column as well. So that will be 1 into 8 minus 1 into 0 divided by 1. So this will be 8. Now this is a square row, and this is 1 and 3 is S cube row, and from there you can find out SS to 1. What is that? 9 minus 8. That is 1/3. That is equal to 1/3. What is the last column? Last column element or last row element, first column. So this is 1/3 into 8 minus 3 into 0 divided by 1/3. So this is 1/3 into 8 divided by 1/3. This is 8. Now what is the conclusion? Conclusion is, in the first row, the elements are 1, 1, 1. Okay, don't say about the 0. So first row elements are 1, 1, 1, and then this 3, 1/3 and 8. The first row elements are 6. Sorry, first column elements are 6, 1, 1, 1, and then 1. This is 3, 1/3 and 8. Okay, so there will be 7 elements in the first column, because it is going up to S to 6. So what are the 7 elements? 1, 1, 1, then 1, 3, 1/3 and 8. All the 7 elements are having same sign. Don't say positive. All the 7 elements are having same size. That means there is no sign change in the Routh-Hurwitz column. That means all the roots of this system will be lying in the negative side of S plane. That means all the poles are stable poles. That means this is going to be a stable system. Second case, it is saying that a zero pivot element, but the entire row is not all zero. So pivot element means the first element. First element is non-zero. First element is zero, and all the other elements are non-zero. So what they are doing? Okay, so they are doing the same thing. So here, this numerical also, you have to remember S to 5, 3 S to 4. 2s cube 6s square 6s plus 9. So in that case, if you are forming the table, so SS to 5 is having 1, 2 and 6. So it is 1, 2 and 6, and second row element is 3, 6 and 9. So 3, 6 and 9, what they have done is 1, 2, 3. So first row is 1, 2, 6, and second row element is 1, 2, 3. And if you are doing that, this 1, 2 and 1, 2, they are producing S cube first element as 0, and S cube second element is 1 into 6 minus 1 into 3 divided by 1. That is 3. Okay. So first element is becoming 0, and second element is becoming 3. And first element, whenever it is 0, replaced by a very small value. So there is a symbol, any symbol you can take. Okay, generally, we write this symbol only. So this is epsilon and 3. Now you calculate. So this is 2 into epsilon minus 3. So 2 into epsilon minus 3. So 2 epsilon minus 3 divided by epsilon. This part. Okay. So this is the first part. And this might become very big. Okay. And why are we doing this? Because in root locus also, you will be finding in the step number 8 or 9 or towards the end, to find marginal gain, okay, we have to use this. So root locus, step number 8 or 9, I don't remember exactly, that there we have to do this Routh-Hurwitz criteria to find two very important things. What is the marginal frequency and what is the marginal gain? Marginal frequency means frequency at which the poles are lying on j omega axis. That means if you are increasing the frequency a little bit more, the pole will shift into the right hand side of S plane. So there is a frequency range for which the poles are confined in the left hand side of S plane. And then if you are increasing the gain, there will come a frequency when the poles will be on j omega axis. And further, if you are increasing the gain, you will be finding that for all frequencies, the gain are going to be positioned in the right side of S plane. So to find whichever is the marginal gain, whichever is the marginal frequency, you have to do Routh-Hurwitz criterion within root locus. Okay, so to do that, all these things you have to understand. So I found the first element to be 0. In that case, I replace it by a very small value. This is epsilon. Then I find a square element. Then from there, I find what is SS to 1 element. And finally, I find what is SS to 0 element. Now here starts the discussion. So now we are entering the more difficult part of it. Now there are a lot of considerations, and this very big paragraph you have to understand exactly how to find out what is the case here, whether the system is going to be stable, unstable, or if the system is going to be stable, what is the boundary condition. So let us go through. It says that, so this epsilon is positive, so 1 1 epsilon, no problem. And then this 3 also is positive. So main problem is with these two cases now. Then what we are going to find is there is going to be a boundary for epsilon for which this system is going to be stable. So how much will be the value of epsilon? Small value. For that only the system is going to be stable. For some other values outside that range, system will be unstable. The first element in rho S square. So there are two discussions, S square rho and SS2 1 rho. Let us find that. So first element in S square rho, 2 epsilon minus 3 by epsilon, which has a negative value if you are finding that if epsilon is less than 3 by 2. Okay, if you are finding that this epsilon is less than 3 by 2, so 3 by 2 in the boundary condition. So if you are taking epsilon is 3 by 2, that means it is 0 by epsilon. Okay, so if epsilon is greater than 3 by 2, this element is 0. This element is positive. That is the first thing you have to understand. Okay, so S square, the first element, we want this element to be positive because all the previous elements are positive. 1, 1, epsilon and last element, all are positive. So if we want this system to be stable, in that case, this epsilon has to be greater than 3 by 2. If it is greater than 3 by 2, in that case, this numerator is going to be positive. If this numerator is going to be positive, that means we are going towards stability of the system. So this is the first boundary condition. So what they're saying is this whatever is 2 epsilon minus 3 by epsilon, which has a negative sign as E tends to 0 in the Raoult stability criterion. So if E becomes E is going towards 0, that means E is less than 3 by 2 and going towards 0. In that case, this system will become negative, or this S square coefficient will become negative. So this first coefficient will be positive if and only if epsilon value is greater than 3 by 2. This is the first thing we have to understand. The term SS2 1. So SS2 1, you are finding, in this case, you are supposed to find out which has a limiting value of 3. Okay, again the same thing you are finding here. Okay, so if you are just putting epsilon is equal to 3 or greater than that, epsilon is equal to 3, eliminating the terms in the first column and all those things. So if you are putting it 3, let's see what happens. So 3 means denominator will be, this is 6, this is 6 minus 3, that is 3. And numerator is 3 into 3 into 3, that is 27 divided by 3, this is 3. In that case, it will be becoming negative. So what they are finding is, the first column SS to 1 rho, 3 minus 3 epsilon square divided by 2 epsilon minus 3, which is a limiting value of plus 3 as E tends to 0. Examining the form in the first column of the Raoult array, it is found that there are two changes in the sign, which implies that there are two poles in the right hand side of S plane. So what I mean to say is, you are not going to find that this system is going to stabilize, or this system is going to find its positive in this for all values of epsilon. So in this case, you are finding that if epsilon is going to 0, epsilon value is very less. So in this case, you are saying that epsilon has to be greater than 3 by 2. In that case only, this S square element is going to be positive. But that is not the case, because
sir, you are not audible.
Sir, your mic is off. Your mic is off, sir. You're not audible.
Okay. So if we are putting s tends to zero, so epsilon tends to zero in both these cases. In the first case, if we put s epsilon tends to zero, we are going to find that this is 2 minus 3. That means this is -3. That means this is going towards somewhere negative. Okay, this is at the denominator, but it will go to minus infinity. So substitute epsilon tends to zero, so this will go to minus infinity. The minus infinity value is not very important. How much is the value is not important. The sign is important. Okay, so this thing is going towards negative if you are putting epsilon to zero. And if you are putting epsilon tends to zero here, so denominator will be -3, denominator will be zero. So this value is going towards +3. So what they have written is the first term of s tends to one row is which has a limiting value of +3 as epsilon tends to zero. Examining the terms in the column in the row value, it is found that there are two sign changes. All the sign changes from epsilon to this negative, from negative to positive. So from epsilon to negative, again from negative to positive. So there are two sign changes. Hence, out of the five poles which are given, two poles are going to be unstable. So this is a very important numerical. It is very well. That is, in the first column, finding that two elements in, and you have to just substitute epsilon tends to zero, you will be finding that the numerator, the first element, a square coefficient, is tending to negative infinity. And the next case is going to be positive. Epsilon tends to zero, this is going to be positive. So we can say that a square element is negative. That means there are two sign changes. From s cube to s square, one sign change. From s square to s to one, there is another change. That means there are two sign changes. So out of five poles, two poles will be in the right hand side. System is unstable. Next, another case that we had substituted with epsilon and we have calculated all the other things. Okay, and you are going to find that these are very big values. Okay, so these are very big values. What we are finding in case of the other thing, to see what is the logic. So this logic is very important. So as epsilon tends to zero, the first element. So epsilon tends to zero, this first element is going to be negative. So just see that as epsilon tends to zero, s tends to one. So s tends to one means zero minus zero. So this element is going to be zero. See, there are four elements of epsilon. So you won't have to take care of the second row element. Sorry, second column element. Only check for the first these three elements which are involving epsilon. So this element. So epsilon square minus epsilon numerator is zero. So whatever is the denominator doesn't matter. So this is going to be zero. Whatever is here, this is -1 minus 1. This is going to be +1. So they are writing epsilon is to zero, s to one, and to zero. So this thing tends to this possibility of existence of imaginary in the extent. We therefore need to examine the auxiliary imaginary just. So what happens? So here you are finding again. Here you are supposed to substitute s to one as a small element, and again you have to carry out. So I am asking you just to check all the numerical here, because all the numerical given in this book are very special, and they are actually a little critical numerical. So up to this 231, starting from the pages when did we start it? So initial cases were very easy. And all this theory not necessary. So this 5.4 article, starting from page number 222 up to 231. Okay, up to 231, all the numericals and all these things have to check, and especially the numerical in the last 2-3 pages. So here I am declaring this topic, that is Routh-Hurwitz criterion, but this topic is never over, because whenever we are doing this root locus, towards the end of every root locus, this Routh-Hurwitz criterion will come. And there will come another numerical which I have not shown you here. You are finding this kind of transfer functions, and the transfer functions are not involving k. So there is another third type of numerical. What is the first type of numerical? Very simple, RH criterion is given, polynomial, and you are finding the full table, and depending on the first column, you are telling me whether it is stable or unstable. That is the first type. Second type is there are two cases. One case, the first element becomes zero, So what you have to do that, in that case, you have to assume a small value, positive value, and finally you have to find all the elements. In the first column, you have to make a comment, or you have to find decision by doing epsilon tends to zero. What are the first column, positive or negative? If there are negative, if there are sign change, the system is going to be unstable. So after substituting epsilon tends to zero in the first column, you are finding all elements are of same sign. That means system is stable. So this is the second type of numerical. Third type of numerical, I'm not doing it here because that type of numerical we will be doing while doing root locus. Here, instead of one, they will say that this value is K, capital K. Okay, in that case, that value will be capital K. And then the question will be, find the range of K for which this system is going to be stable. I'll tell you, instead of this one, so there will be a constant, or K can be here. So 3 plus K into X cube, that is also possible. So in this elements, you'll be finding some element of K. And what is K? K is nothing but given as system gain. In this English channel Boring Experiment, we have seen that K, different two values were taken. So K was taken as 20, K was taken as 100. When K was taken as 100, we found out that system settling time is faster. Whenever K was taken as 20, we found that system steady state value is better. So all those things we have seen. Okay, so this equation, instead of some constant, the gain thing will come here. So what is that gain? Gain is K. And the question will be, find that range of K for which the system is going to be stable. So we will do those kind of numerical, and I'm not doing it here separately because in Routh-Hurwitz, as a part of root locus, we will do that. Okay. And that case, it will be smaller numerical. It will not be of order 6 or something. Generally, this is order 2 or 3 or 4 maximum. In case of root locus, when we will be solving Routh-Hurwitz, it will be order 2, 3, 4. And in that time, it will be easier for us to understand and find out what is the value of K for which the system is going to be stable. So in that case, the K will be range bound. We'll be finding that if the K value is between 0 to 40, in that case, the first column elements will be all positive or all same sign. In that case, we can comment that, yes, if we are keeping the system gain in between 0 to 40 value, then the system is going to be stable. So that will be an application. Still now, our Routh-Hurwitz criterion thing is not completed, because application of RH criterion we will find when we are doing root locus. So all this that we are doing now, we have done till today, it's actually a build up for root locus. So we will start with root locus numerical from tomorrow onwards. And it's a request to all of you, as you have joined today, you have joined on time, do tomorrow also. And tomorrow onwards, coming 4 or 5 lectures, nobody misses. Because root locus, if you don't listen to me or if you don't listen to an instructor, then you cannot understand. There are a lot of intermediate steps, and I will explain why it to be done. There are a lot of cases. So please attend all the lectures in root locus, because it's a 10-step process. Every numerical, we have to do some 10 steps. Some of the steps might not be applicable for every numerical, but there are 10 steps. Okay, so that I'll be explaining tomorrow onwards. So coming 4 or 5 lectures are very important. As long as we are doing root locus and Bode plot, after that we will do, that is also very tricky. So whatever we have done today is a build up.